Welcome to the Two Blokes Chatting Radio Show on 94.7 The Pulse. Music, interviews, news, and, well, Two Blokes Chatting. Now, here are the two blokes.
I was told to play it. He told me I had to play it. It's Rob's little joke. Rob, I'll let you do the honours.
Gentleman who joins me on Mondays on Front Page. You'll be my co-host for 2 hours on this coming Monday.
That's on a special, Front Page. Coach special of type Geelong of punishment ahead of you, Nick.
177 games of cricket in England for Lancashire and Durham. Coach of the Geelong Cricket Club, Nick Speak, good morning.
And good morning to you both. Two blokes arguing, I think, rather than two blokes chatting.
Yeah. Oh, we've stick around, by quarter to 11, it'll be two blokes punching on.
Right.
And then
right.
Then it'll be one bloke storming out.
Yeah, arguing's not.
We've mentioned a lot about the international cricket at Cadinia Park today, but how on earth did that happen? Because you were very sad, thinking, oh, no cricket, with a delayed start, but whoosh, it's on.
Yeah, it's been on the radar for a while. We just weren't sure. Obviously, we were expecting to play today. We were always playing them Tuesday. We were actually playing them Tuesday and Thursday, 50-over game Tuesday at Cadinia Park and a T20 Thursday afternoon. So they're staying at the Ridges.
Sponsor of the Geelong Cricket Club.
Sponsor of the Geelong Cricket Club. They've sort of chosen Geelong as a base before they go into the prequel. Their sort of little tournament to try and get into the main, you know.
So they'd be busting more than you to have some cricket.
Yeah, well, they're coming off, they've been playing in Dubai. They've played some practice games against, I think they were bilateral games against Bangladesh. Nearly beat them in the first one, lost them pretty heavily in the second one. Not that I've been doing any scouting on them, but they're coached by Robin Singh. Remember Robin Singh?
Yeah.
Played for India, played a few tests, but played a lot of one days. Yeah. Good, very skillful player. So I met him a long, long time ago, so I'm looking forward to meeting him or seeing him again today.
I would have thought part of the aspect of it would be acclimatization. I'm doing well, aren't I, today? The fact that they would be used to playing in really hot, humid conditions in the UAE and then coming down here, just what it wasn't last Saturday, went about 14 degrees max, I think, wasn't it?
A bit better today. Hey, Nick, you'd have a bit of an idea from your travels around, you know, the level of Premier Cricket compared to state cricket. Where would the UAE fit, do you think, as an opponent level? Is it a guess, or you got a rough idea?
I think that probably, I guess, it probably would be a guess, but it would be somewhere. It'd be closer to state cricket than club cricket.
Mm.
So, you know, maybe in between there. And maybe I'm doing them a disservice. Maybe they are basically a state team, probably.
Yeah.
Famously at one of the, I think, 50-over tournaments, Canada had a bloke called John Davison who used to play a fair bit of cricket in Australia.
Yeah.
Do the UAE side have a number of expats like that, or are they all locals?
There's a lot of locals. There's obviously Pakistanis very close to, it's just across the water. I'm looking forward to, I really don't know any names, so I'm not going to fall into that trap of trying to pronounce. They have a 16-year-old batsman, who apparently is an incredible talent, and he's a local guy from the UAE. I won't try and say that Emiratian word. And we have a 16-year-old sort of prodigy playing today too.
I was going to ask you about him, which is good.
I know he's one of your favourites, Rob, but Oliver Peake is going to, we've snuck him into the 12 today. We're playing 12, so.
I'm very pleased because there's been a lot of talk about him, and the poor kid's got weight of expectation just on the achievements of his father, but also his junior stuff. But it's good to see he's going to get an outing, and that's another reason if you want to get down to Cadinia Park today and hopefully see Ollie Peake playing in the first 11 at Geelong, albeit unofficial, but for the first time.
He's batting down the order. As I say, we're playing 12, so he'll be batting at 7 or 8, but it'll be good to see him out there.
He looked very competent in the nets on Thursday night, exactly what I expected. The hype's been good, but he looks a very, very well-organised player.
Yeah, he is. Left-hander, nice player, plays on top of the bounce. I can't remember Clinton too much. I played against him, but, you know, they all say he's very similar in stature. And, he has a I mean, he's, I guess his cricket IQ for a 16-year-old is, he's well ahead of a 16-year-old, so you know, that will serve him well.
I reckon the best way to describe what I saw of Clinton Peake at his very best was a slightly shorter version of David Gower. Just a beautiful, beautiful player.
Right. Mm. Well, there you go. Mm. Dealt in the offside only. Yeah, David Gower. David.
Savage through point and cover, and the ability to just hit the ball to get ones was a great feature of his game, and running between wickets to support it.
Yeah,
beautiful to watch.
Right.
Yeah, looking forward to the young bloke. If he's half as good as his old man, he'll be a ripper.
All right. Well, yeah, we hope so.
Yep.
I guess it's one of the nice things about kids coming through like that that come from a Geelong background, or, you know, I know we've got a big link with the Western Districts and stuff, but not having to import guys from Melbourne to come and play, that's really a testament to the pathway process.
Yeah, I mean, there's a conveyor belt, Neil, of them. He's, you know, he's not alone. And Liam Blackford is a very, very good talent. Henry Melville from Colac. Fletcher Cousins from down Warrnambool way. Yeah, there's a real pool of talent, not just male either. There's a, you know, there's like the girls section, the ladies section. There's a heap of talent, you know, in the area. It's only going to get better. I mean, the facilities. We were there Thursday, Rob, for the launch, and what we're expecting from a cricket sense, from the redevelopment of the ground is going to be terrific.
Because I saw, I was invited to a function probably getting on to 18 months ago when the plans were being designed, and at that stage there was a lot of, wow, and it sounds like it's coming together.
Yeah, it is. I mean, they keep telling us it's going to be there in May, and we're going to have an indoor, basically, a five-lane indoor facility, and there's, well, a sod's not been turned yet, but they're confident they're going to get there, and the actual Geelong Cricket Club rooms on the back of the, you know, the football stand, the new stand at the City End, is that right?
Yep, yes.
Which they've named, they're going to name that the Selwood End, aren't they? The Goals.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh, there's another scoop for us.
So Gary's got the flick already.
No, he's got, well, whoever was there is going to the other end, I think.
Oh, so Doug Wade's got the flick.
No, Doug Wade's been gone a while. He's just got the gate now.
Yeah, he has, hasn't he?
Gary Ablett had the terrace. So Bobby Davis has got a gate, and Bernie Smith's got a gate. They might be slowly oozing out the other.
All right. It probably needs some fact checking.
Yeah, no, that's okay. And with any reference to Doug Wade, we should say good morning to Ian Cover, who'd be having a listen. He's got a famous story about Jeff Leake and Doug Wade. We'll tell her off air, but good morning, Cove. You'll be listening.
Now, Nick, as a coach, at this time of year, Nets sessions are all well and good, but you don't really know about game sense. But you've got a couple who have played a bit. Spoke to them both Thursday night. Tick and Tock, Tom O'Connell and Brodie Couch have been playing a bit, and they're really upbeat, excited, and feeling good about where they're at. It must be handy to have a couple in the side. And Blackford, of course, has played a lot of cricket. So a few that are actually in good nick.
Jackson as well.
Spent
the winter in Darwin. Yeah. I mean, that's right. It's, you know, trying to hit the ground running is trying to time your run at the back end of the season, and trying to obviously hit the ground running at the start of the season are keys. So yeah, I mean, we're confident. Isn't Geelong? I mean, I've been consumed by the football just like everybody else the last two or three weeks, and I've thoroughly enjoyed it. And so it'll take a little while to, you know, I guess for the town to change a little bit. Towards the cricket, you know, you still walk around Geelong and you can see people with the kit on and they're still smiling. And
yeah, unless,
you know,
of course, you're a Brisbane supporter like me, in which case every time you see it, you go...
Right, yeah. What is the percentage? It's like...
65 the last time I heard.
65%, so 35% don't barrack.
Correct.
For Geelong.
Now, that may have changed with the influx of population of late, but that was probably 3 or 4 years ago. It was 65% was the estimate.
So it might have gone down
because
more then.
The people coming in from Melbourne, you know, they, someone's saying, I am indeed listening, someone said. So I better have a, I better find out who that is.
And it might be Colac, I reckon.
Might be. But yes, so I think it's probably 60, something like that.
Right.
More than half, I would think.
Yeah. Definitely noticeable in recent times for me, Nick, that on the back of what Neil said, we've got this huge influx of people who are coming to Geelong but aren't Geelong people, so they're bringing their own, as they should. I mean, you barrack for the Tigers yourself.
Not anymore. I barrack for Geelong now.
Oh, what's the name for someone who changes teams midstream?
My two kids did it. They both, not kids, my children, my grown-up children now, both switched teams. My daughter went from Essendon to Richmond, and my son Kenny went from somebody to Hawthorn just at the right time too, when they when they
sensed
started
it.
Well, he sensed it. Something happened at school, you know, they go to school and
By the way, I've just determined who that was because it just flashed up on my screen. It was in fact Ian Cove. I said good morning all.
Good morning, Cove. Yeah. Good to have you aboard.
He is indeed
again.
Listening, yes.
I thought he'd be on the golf course, Cove.
He might even be. He might be streaming on the phone.
You or using that very fine Community Radio Plus app that is available to download and gives you all community stations across Australia.
Well done, Neil Vallow.
You wouldn't be allowed to phone at the Barwon Heads Golf Club, would you? Surely not. You'd have to leave your phone in the car, in the car park, down the street.
Or as our old mate Tony Gregg would have said, in the car park.
In the car park.
Let's talk, I like tapping into your international experience. So you spend a bit of time back home in England and in the US. Do people tend to change over there, or is it very much the tribal supporting of their teams as it is in Australia?
I think in the UK it's very, very tribal with football.
Yeah.
So there's not a lot of change there, no. Cricket is, you know, there's a real debate going on in England at the moment around scheduling and county cricket and the importance of it and how they're going to restructure Sir Andrew Strauss.
Is he a knight already?
He's a sir, yeah. It's
yours is only a matter of time, isn't it?
The hand, isn't it? Willy nilly.
What was it? Who got ridiculed for? So the Ashes, when they won in 2005, was it? Paul Collingwood
got the MBE.
He got the MBE.
Yeah.
Warnie gave it to him, didn't he?
For making eight runs in the series.
He made 17 runs in the series. And if I roomed with Paul Collingwood for 2 years at Durham when I went up there. Like, that was kind of one of my jobs, to try and get him back on the straight and narrow. He was not a lunatic, but he was just a great lad, you know, lovely lad from the northeast.
Enjoyed
of England.
His life.
He did, and he still is. No doubt he would be.
And I think that's why the Australian supporters probably liked him a bit. He had a bit of Australian flair about him.
Yeah. Do you want to know an interesting fact about Paul Collingwood? He was a joint Ryder medal winner.
Really?
In Melbourne, yeah. Mm.
In his early days before...
Played two seasons. He originally came out and played for Baldwin, maybe.
That's sub-district.
Subbies. Yeah. And then he played at Richmond.
All right.
And he shared the Ryder medal with, I'm not sure, but he
did. Research.
The unforgettable, what's his name?
Gary Watts' his name, yeah.
Yeah.
So England is, there's a bit of, not turmoil, but, you know, how, so the counties, so people who support counties, it's obviously it's where you live, and it's the summer, you know, it's generally a lot of older people who have retired or retiring, and they have the time to spend, and, you know, they want to go and watch the cricket. So Mr. Strauss is proposing a six-team only first division. So there's 18 counties, which would leave. Then he wants to have two divisions, like lower divisions, on the same level, but only have. So he's mirroring, the Shield cricket. You know, he's mirroring cricket.
Just on that, 18 teams to try and pick the elite 11 players. It's the same in Premier Cricket. We're trying to find our very, very best first class cricketers in the state of Victoria. 18, it looks to be too much, but there's the politics of saying, well, if it's too many, who misses out? And no one's game to touch it seems. So we have 18,
right.
And that's the way we deal with it.
Yeah.
But is, in your opinion, to get really practice the or find the elite, is it spreading the talent too thin across 18?
Premier Cricket. There's all the pathways that are in place now, and, you know, there's not that many players actually go from Premier Cricket to a contract. You know, they're generally, they might be coming from interstate, or they're basically through the pathway. So they've been identified, play, you know, Ollie Peak has played 15s, he'll play, he's actually bypassing 17s. He's bottom age under 17, but he'll play under 19 for Victoria this year.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a progression there. In England, it's definitely too wide. You know, and that's what Strauss is proposing. We're six teams is basically to funnel all the best players up into them six teams.
And then would they encourage the players and the clubs contractually to make sure that the best do funnel up? Or,
well, that's one of the that's one of the burning questions. Is like, you know, a county like Somerset who produce a player like, you know, Marcus Trescothick or somebody of his ilk now, he just gets shipped off to Middlesex or to Lancashire,
yeah,
you know,
yeah,
as one of the top clubs, the six, yeah, clubs. Historically, Rob, it's always been there. Mike Atherton is, incredibly smart guy around cricket and obviously writes for the Times. And there's some really good stuff online that he's sort of exploring the pros and the cons of it.
Yeah.
And his argument is like, county cricket is county cricket. It's kind of doesn't make a lot of sense. There are too many teams and there's people playing that maybe shouldn't be playing, but it's kind of the way it's been. And it's, you know, just kind of leave it, I think.
We had the conversation about Tim David, who is playing cricket for Australia. And I honestly thought when he popped up in that 2020 comp, the Big Bash, that he must have been an import from somewhere else and he just come in. And yeah, I didn't realise that he's actually an Australian. Hadn't played for Western Australia, but he's playing in the Premier 2020 comp just on his extraordinary ability to hit the ball. So that's an example of bypassing the normal system,
yeah,
the way modern cricket's structured.
A chap called Dave Warner did that as well, as I recall.
Yeah, he sort of
came to prominence
playing some 50-over cricket or something.
Well, he played for Australia before he played for New South Wales.
Mm-hmm.
Which is unusual, because normally you play for New South Wales, then you play for Australia.
Yeah, well, isn't it? You get given your blue cap and you get a green one as well, correct, don't, yeah, you?
Apparently he opened the bags in the wrong order. That's how he ended up in Australia.
Yeah, I'm paying that. That's pretty good.
It's a different time to when Australia's great Ian Redpath played for the country. Speaking of that, very big day on Tuesday. John Craven is launching his book, 100 Greatest Geelong Sportsmen. Quite excited about that. The three great local test cricketers are going to be involved in the launch. Alan Connolly, Ian Redpath, and who's the other one?
The unforgettable, what's his name?
Yeah. How could I forget
that? Did he share the Ryder Medal with Paul Collingwood, maybe?
Who's the other one?
I don't know. Bob Merriman?
Sheehan Connolly. Paul Sheehan.
Paul Sheehan, yeah.
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 To be launching John Craven's book, which is a great, great story. To get in for the Australian rules side of it, you've got to win a Brownlow medal. So there'll be one Ablett, not two.
Mm. What do you think about missing out on that, Rob?
How do you think? Do you know that he's out? He could be at number not 101.
No, I've had a sneak peek.
Okay,
I've got an invitation to launch. I'll take
that. Is that a sneak? A sneak peek?
Something like that. Yeah. No, John was in, wasn't he, a couple of weeks ago when I was co-hosting with you, I think. Or
yeah,
something,
that the day you co-hosted, and we'll do that again. We've got a surprise guest coming in on Monday too when you're co-hosting. Peter Ryan from The Age will be joining us for a chat on
not a
Monday.
Surprise, not a surprise guest anymore.
No, okay.
No, so do some research. He's a very good cricket and football writer with The Age. He's going to be joining us in the studio on Monday at 10 o'clock, where Nick Speak will be co-hosting The Front Page. Looking forward to that.
Yeah, I'll tell you what.
He's absolutely flabbergasted.
We all feel a bit that way when we've got the opportunity to spend time on radio with you, Rob. Now, Cove reports that he played golf Monday, Wednesday and Friday and he's resting this morning. Now, I might be embellishing the message a little bit. He's organised his week so that he can be sitting at home listening to the two blokes chatting on a Saturday morning.
Magnificent.
Part of that was made up. One question I do want to ask you, Nick, before we get to wind things up, unfortunately, because we are running a bit short on time. There's a bloke called Aaron Finch who has played a bit of cricket over the journey, who appears on the surface to be playing one more tournament and then giving it away. Mm-hmm. How does that work with the Geelong Cricket Club? Is he going to come back to the club, do you know? Are you not allowed to tell you? Obviously, he's a great player to have around.
Yeah, I mean, we're hopeful that he will come back into the fold of Geelong in some way. He's put his name to an academy, which is launching this year, an under 14 and 15 academy. So it's just kind of soft steps, I think, Neil. And he's got some pretty serious business at hand over the next two months, six weeks. I did think, Rob and Neil, that there was some encouraging signs in the three games in India. Neil, Rob, he's just, we've got to get him on T20. He turns his nose up.
Yeah.
I know. It's,
I'm coming around.
We will get you there. But they were three really, really high quality games of cricket that they played in India. And Finchie was, yeah, he was starting to move better, and his footwork patterns, as we say, were a little bit more convincing, and the bat swing was more down the line as a crow, you know, as opposed to...
And I think one of the things that always sticks in my mind, if you ever saw me bat, Nick, you would say, I'm only a bowler because I can't bat. I couldn't bowl either. But I was the sort of person that would go out and have a swing, and if I connected, great, if not. But you make one mistake when you're batting and you're stuffed. Whereas you're a bowler, you miss the pitch, it doesn't matter, they throw you the ball and say, have another six. That, to me, is one of the great criminal aspects of cricket, if you like. So if Finchie has one mistake early in his innings, he doesn't get a chance to rebuild it, does he? That, to me, is part of the issue.
Yeah, I'd still prefer in T20 cricket to be a batter than a bowler, though, because, you know, the way batters... I mean, the way it's approached now, like Cameron Green opened the batting in all three games. He basically tried to hit every ball for six. If you watch any of the film, he just opens his front leg and, like you said, Neil, he's just having a swing. I mean, it's educated swinging, but he's trying to hit. So he's trying to hit you for 30. He's trying to hit you for 6 sixes. I don't want to be the guy that goes for 36, you know. Malcolm Nash, back in the day.
Yes.
Glamorgan.
Yes.
Gary Sobers.
I remember reading about, yeah. That's a very famous cricketing name, the man at the other end of Sobers.
I know.
One day when we've got more time and you're really bored, I'll tell you about the day when I opened the batting, which was very, very rare. And at the end of the first over, our club was none for 26.
Nice.
Yeah. Nice. Having said to the young fellow at the other end, we might just block a few and see how we go. At the end of the over, he came down and said, what happened to block a few?
Right.
That day I made 26. Sadly, I was out the seventh ball, but that's another story for another time. We probably need to wind this up, Rob.
Yeah, just a little bit. It's good to have cricket back. It is my favourite game when all said and done. I love the footy you get involved in. It's all a lot of hype, but if you really want to get into the intricacies of sport and being serious, and the comment you made before about the life of a batsman, one error, and, well, your first game at Geelong, Nick, is a good example of that, isn't it? Did you travel from Gippsland to Geelong to play once?
Yeah, I think that story was, I think I was going to Albury, actually.
You went to Albury, were you?
I was playing for Dandenong, and we played St Kilda in Albury. And I was run out. Ian Harvey ran me out without facing the ball. And I flew in on the Friday, and I stayed in Leongatha on the Friday night and drove from there Saturday morning to... No, sorry, on Friday night, I drove from there to Albury to play Saturday. You know, it was the old country round. Remember, we got shipped out?
Yeah.
And I got run out without facing a ball.
You saw a bit of Victoria, though.
Yeah, I did. I did. It was my first trip to Melbourne. I did play here inside the ground.
On the footy ground, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I got out second last ball of the last over of the first day of a 2 day game, caught hooking. It was just the most stupid shot. It was crazy.
And what was the name of the grandstand directly behind where? Because it could be anything based on what Rob was saying earlier. They keep changing.
Keep changing the name as another legend falls off the end of the conveyor belt. They've got to make a stand.
Right.
Nick, we better get going because it is 29 minutes to 11. Sorry to cut you off. That was rude, wasn't it? You were just about to finish your story, weren't you?
No. I'm good. I'll save it for next time.
Well, probably Monday morning, apparently, because you'll be back.
Right. You'll be back. But I've got to be serious, haven't I? Co-hosting.
For the first hour,
right?
Be serious. And then after 10
I'm
o'clock.
I'm always serious.
Back after the truck 10 up, o'clock, this was serious.
We'll loosen up a bit after 10.
All right.
I thought we were being serious now.
No, it's been a pleasure. Thank you.
Great good to on have you, mate. You on board. This is the Two Blokes Chatting Radio Show.
Oh, hang on quickly. What time's the game start this afternoon?
2 o'clock.
2 o'clock at Gidinia Park for high quality cricket this afternoon.
Two today, 10:30 Tuesday, and 4 o'clock next Thursday.
Brilliant. On the oval at the city end of the main stadium.
Correct.
At the Selwood end.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, I just thought it was easier to call it the city end just for the... Because otherwise you have people walking around going, there's no Selwood end.
The city end, yep. Neil. Correct.
Thanks, Nick. And Nick Speak joining us here on The Two Blokes Chatting.